Again, welcome to the Bible Christians of God. Appreciate you joining us, and happy Sabbath day to the sons and daughters of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and to the born again by the word of God. Appreciate you and your support, and thank all of you who are joining us also Facebook live stream. And this, the Lord's Sabbath day, where the Lord commanded us to be here. And today is a continuation of last week. We dealt with comparison. We had the KJV Holy Bible and comparing it to the copyrighted Bibles of the day. Again, this is a continuation of that. And as we saw clearly last week, there was no contest. We saw how they corrupted the Old Testament in these new Bible versions, how they actually started certain doctrines, how they do not acknowledge the Creator, how they do instead put their own doctrines into their Bibles and have proliferated those Bibles amongst the congregations of the world. So we are emphatically KJV Bible, Holy Bible believers, defenders. If somebody want to call me a KJV only, okay. Nevertheless, I stand ready to give an answer to every point and against the book, because they stand against the word of God, those that stand against truth, those that stand against what thus saith the Lord. And the Lord said, be ready to give an answer to every man that asks you the reason of the hope. So my answer comes from this book. The book, so help me book. And if you ain't on book, but if you're on book, you're good with me. I don't care what color you is. So with that being said, I want to kind of squash a little myth that's been put out there on our way to comparison before we get into the comparison part, because that's going to be the really funny part, y'all, when we start comparing these scriptures, y'all. But I wanted to bring up right quick why modern day translations of the Bible have a copyright, okay? And the answer is that the modern day English translations continue to corrupt due to being copywritten, whereas the KJV is uncopywritten. We dealt with how we know that without any doubt that the KJV is uncopywritten. And I want to stay here why it could be proven that the Bible publishers should be more lenient when enforcing their copyrights. Having a Bible translation copyrighted is wrong, because when you copyright a Bible, you just took it to your ownership. You own it. Anyone that has copyrighted literature, anyone that has copyrighted music, you understand clearly what I'm talking about. And copyright means you take ownership. So to copyright a Bible, it is no longer the word of God, but it is indeed the word of men. Now the key point is this: it's actually established that the existence of the copyright does impact the quality of a translation. The fact is that a Bible publisher is seeking to make a profit from the sale of a Bible. Yes, they do. They just making money, y'all. They just in it for the money, not in it for the truth, because if they were, they wouldn't copyright the Bible. It is simple as that. And it's big business in these churches nowadays, especially the ones that don't want to hear the word of God. So the translation process is severely compromised. And we've already demonstrated that last week in part one with the Old Testament. And we're going to surely show you clearly in the New Testament that these books are in fact corrupt perversions, and they are not the word of God. And we're going to actually take some just time right quick. I'm going to point out what each one of these Bible versions were attempting. Some of them were attempting word for word. Some of them call themselves amplifying on the word. Some of them call themselves doing thought for thought. But let's go into the book and go to Isaiah 55 and verse 8. Isaiah 55 and verse 8. Again, those of you joining us, welcome to the Bible Christians of God. And we are Bible Christians. If it ain't in this book, you subject to an assessment and evaluation. Okay? You on book, we all good. That's all we have to say. Even if you speak another language, give me a translator, man. If you talk in a book, you good. You is golden. But we're going to go to Isaiah 55 and verse 8. And then we're going to look at, in fact, what I'm going to break it down to is first, we're going to establish what God's thoughts is, okay? Where his will is. And then we're going to start our comparison in the New Testament, okay? We're going to start our comparison in the New Testament. And we're going to show you emphatically that these new corrupt Bibles, A, they bother verses that don't need bothering. They delete the word of God. And they, in fact, I'm going to show you in particular doctrines, they collapse on themselves. These books implode against themselves. And we'll show you why. But let's look at what the word says right here. Isaiah 55 and verse 8. When you get some, read.
For my thoughts are not your thoughts.
See, the book tells our thoughts. It's not the Lord's thoughts. So he said, my thoughts are not your thoughts. Go ahead.
Neither are your ways my ways, saith the Lord.
See, that's why we got to learn the ways of the Lord. Because the book can tell you the way of a man, the way of a man is right in his own eyes, but the Lord pondered the hearts. Who's looking for the Lord's way? Go ahead.
For as the heavens are higher than the earth,
yes, sir,
so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts.
See, the Lord, see, when you elevate yourself above your own thoughts, you begin to realize there's a higher power, there's a higher level of thinking, there's a higher level of thought, there is a higher way. Like I said, give me a higher love, a higher way than what man would have. So you got to come to the Word to get that. And if you didn't come to the Word of God, then you're not getting the Lord's thoughts, you're not getting the Lord's ways, and you're going to fall victim to these false prophets, false theologies, false ideology, opinions and theories and thoughts of men. And when you wake up in the eighth day on Judgment Day, and you standing there, you saying you did this in the name of the Lord, and you did that in the name of the Lord, and he tell you, I never knew you, guess what? You never got his thoughts, you never entered into his way. Okay? So, go ahead.
For as the rain cometh down and the snow from heaven, and returneth not thither, but watereth the earth, and maketh it bring forth and bud, that it may give seed to the sower, and bread to the eater.
See, so the Lord gave me something natural that you can actually perceive and understand and grasp, so that you can understand how this word hits us, and how we are to react to this word. Because this said, like the rain coming down from heaven, and the snow from heaven, and return not thither, but water to earth, and make it to bring forth and bud. So that's how you have to get the word of God. That's why, another answer to why people are doing wickedness and all this stuff, even though they're in the churches and all that, because they're not allowing the word of God to permeate them. You don't get the word of God, and you ain't growing nothing. You won't stay the same. There is no spiritual growth if you are not receiving the word of God to bring forth and bud, that it may give seed to the sower and bread to the eater. Go ahead.
So shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth.
Yes, sir.
It shall not return unto me void, but it shall accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper in the thing whereto I sent it.
Now look, let's go to Isaiah 41 and 21, and we're going to produce our strong cause because as we drop this book, we're going to show you that indeed they corrupted the New Testament to the extent that you ain't got the Word of God. You simply don't. Now, part one, I went to all the copyrights and everything. So if you want to know when the particular version was copywritten, see part one. We again are on part two. So Isaiah 41 and 21. And then we're going to get into this, some comparison, y'all. I'm going to pick this up because we got a lot to do. I'm going to try to go book by book in the New Testament, all the way to Revelation. So we'll see how far I get today. So Isaiah 41 and 21. Read.
Produce your cause,
yes, sir,
saith the Lord.
Yes, sir.
Bring forth your strong reasons, saith the King of Jacob.
See, this is what we're going to do. We're going to produce our cause. Why these copywritten books are no good, why they are perverted, and we're going to clearly understand why they are to be avoided. Now, I want to bring up this point because there is a myth out there that some man created the New Testament way after the apostles. But I want to bring up this piece about Marcion. And this is mostly Hebrew brethren that hate the New Testament they'll come out with this. But I want to bring this point up here, because this established the fact that, A, Emperor Constantine didn't create the Bible or the New Testament. And we're going to see, as I read this piece of paper, that historical information, that the New Testament had been intact way before Marcion, and that the apostles, by the time you got to 70 AD, 90 AD, when the apostle John sealed the deal, the Lord gave him the seal of the deal at the last chapter, all of the Bible was intact, y'all. So this thing is about Marcion. Now Marcion, to kind of give you a summary, he is the equivalent of those that hate the Old Testament. The Old Testament, you see those Bibles without the New Old Testament, well, that's a Marcionite, or that's an infection of being a Marcionite, and you're going to see exactly what I mean. Now, this guy Marcion was born in Sinope in AD 85 in the northern province of Pontus, in which is now called Turkey, on the coast of the Black Sea. Marcion, the son of a bishop, was intelligent, capable, hard, unbending, vainly rich, an ambitious man. He made his way to Rome sometime between AD 135 and 139. Now, this is actually during the time of the persecution of, I have to put a hand on, the Bible Christians. This was during the time of great persecution. So this guy, during the time of great persecution, he rose up. And he was accepted as a Christian. We're going to find out what kind of Christian. Into the churches there. He gave a large gift to the congregation, and his stint in the church at Rome, however, did not last long. He was formally excommunicated in AD 144, and his lavish gifts promptly returned. Marcion was one of the most successful heretics in the early church. He was opposed by everyone who was everyone, who was anyone rather. For nearly a century after his death, he was the arch heretic opposed to he was an arch heretic and was called the firstborn of Satan by Justin Martyr, Irenaeus, Clement, Tertullian, Hypatius, and Origen. He was one of the few heretics that the Greek and Latin Christians united in condemning. After his excommunication, he traveled around the world as a missionary for his version of Christianity. He won a lot of converts. And according to Tertullian, he planted churches as wasps make nests, teaching men to deny that God is the maker of all things in heaven and earth, and the Christ predicted by the prophets is his son. Marcion's church was rigorous, demanding, inspiring, and it was well organized, and for about a century, fairly successful. Now, here's Marcion's theological errors, and trust me, you got same Christians believing this stuff we read right here, right now. Watch it. Marcion's theological error was, and it was many, came from one main root. He refused to believe that the God of the Old Testament was the same God of the New Testament. Okay? Marcion simply could not believe that a God full of wrath could be a God full of wrath and justice. And we could go read in the New Testament. The book say, behold the goodness and severity of God. So you have to understand the totality of God. You just can't be running around saying, oh, God is good. God is good. God is good. Look, you had to go out there in the street and see how God dropped terror. We could read in the book what the New Testament said. Knowing the terror of the Lord, we persuade men. You got to know the terror. God ain't just, God is good. He's good all the time. Man, look, that's another lesson, though. But nevertheless, this guy rejected the fact that God could be a God of wrath and justice. So he threw away the Old Testament. He threw it away. He threw away the Old Testament, y'all, and took for his Bible a truncated version of Luke's gospel and selectively, here's the thing now, selectively edited versions of Paul's epistles. Who that sound like, y'all? Pick a spot tomorrow. Pick a spot tomorrow and watch what happens. Okay? So, a lot of them carry this mentality. They throw away the Old Testament, and this come out of Marcionism. So now, Marcion held that Christianity held, sorry, let me finish this. Marcion had the Christianity that he wanted. See, That's the key. He had the Christianity that he wanted, not what the Bible gave you, and that's a big difference. That's why when we said, so you said to somebody, you a Bible Christian, they be like, brother, what's that? I'm like, wow, the one that come from the Bible, that's the Christianity. But this Marcion had the Christianity he wanted, a God of goodness and nothing else. A God of mess-inspiring moral uplift. A Bible that does away with the uncomfortable bits about God's wrath and hell. Marcionism was an antinomy, an idealistic about the human potential, and skittish and about dogma and rules. In other words, he was going around calling those that believed in the Old Testament legalists. Brother, you got that legalistic doctrine. That's Marcion talking right there. So now, here's how Angela Tibbe describes Marcion in Heresies and how to avoid them, edited by Ben Quash and Michael Ward. For him, there was a fundamental contradiction between the law and love, righteousness and grace. Think about that. To him, there's a contradiction between law and love. How many ministers do you hear preaching? Brother, you can't have law, you got. Yeah, Marcionism. Righteousness and grace. Marcion thought that true Christianity was flawed by the incompatibilities at the heart of its teachers. His solution was radical. Nothing less than a reinstatement of faith would do. And for Marcion, that reinstatement had to focus on what for him was the essential gospel, the love, mercy, and compassion displayed in the life and teachings of Jesus. This, for him, was all that was necessary. That's why when the Lord bring his judgment on this earth, so many people are going to be shocked. Oh, God, can't. This couldn't happen by God. Oh, yeah. That's why it's going to be a horrible day when the Lord really drop his wrath. He brings some now. People getting, they're really like, how could God do this? Yeah. We've seen the shadow that what's really headed this way. Propping up nowadays, y'all. So for him, all that was necessary was the compassion and display in the life of the teachings of Jesus. And this for him was all that was necessary. It was the blueprint for a new and pure humanity. There was no other truly Christian foundation for belief or morality. What Marcion couldn't bear was the note of judgment, that went along with the preaching of the Christian message. The warnings that came with the teaching of the law, the call to obedience, and the threat of the lake of fire. Oh no, brother, we can't talk that, brother. We can't talk about Judgment Day. You got some Sabbath day classes that don't even teach Judgment Day. They omit it. Omit it, which is the end. They completely misconstrued it. But it states here, he couldn't get with the warnings that came with the teaching of the law, the call to obedience, and the threat of the lake of fire. For Marcion, the picture of God, given at Mount Sinai, a God whose presence is manifested in thunder and lightning with people cowering in dread. Didn't it say the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom? So if you don't have no fear of God, what wisdom you got? Nevertheless, he said, with whom they were afraid to communicate. God cannot be God, the God and Father of the Lord Jesus Christ. As he saw, the Christianity of his day needed purging so that the pure gospel could be received in all its radical simplicity and appeal to the heart. Since the Bible didn't have what he wanted, Marcion decided to make a better Bible. So he decided to create his own Bible. Now, he couldn't copyright because there wasn't no such thing as copyrights back then. So now, with that being said, I want to get that little tidbit so you can understand where brothers talk to him. Oh man, Marcion made that New Testament. Child, please. We're going to move right along. So let's do ourselves a favor, and I'm going to go now into, let's do ourselves a favor and start the comparison, y'all. Here's what I want to do. We're going to read from these new, we're going to read from the KJV, because this is the KJV versus the copywritten Bibles, okay? So we're going to read what the KJV says, And then we're going to read what some of these other versions, I'm going to give you their copyright dates just in case you wasn't able to see part one. And we're going to look at what they say as opposed to the word of God, okay? So now we're going to read starting in our comparison, okay? So here we go. In this corner, we got the KJV, ring the bell, ding, 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 here we go. And in this corner, we got the NSB, ESV, CSB, NRVS, NAB, NIV, New Living Translation, and CEB, okay? We open up the round, so we're going to start. And I'm going to let you know what word to underline in the if you got a KJV. And we're going to compare to what's coming out of these new copywritten Bibles. So now let's do our favor by starting. We're going to start doctrine. We're going to look at, first of all, the Word of God. Do these new versions delete the Word of God? We're going to start there first by going to Luke 4 and 4. Luke 4th chapter and verse 4. Oh, we got a long ways to go, y'all. I'm going to try to walk it down every book all the way to Revelation. So we got a long ways to go, y'all. Long ways to go. I don't know if I'm going to be able to get all this in this part two. We might have a part three, y'all. Anyway, but Luke 4 and 4. And this is, man, this is going to get hilarious, y'all. Trust me. You're going to be like, what? Anyway, and you're going to be like, they did that. Yeah, they did that. Anyway, so Luke 4 and 4. Let's hear from the KJV. Read, son.
And Jesus answered him, saying, it is written that man should not live by bread alone, but by every word of God.
Now, I want everyone in your KJV to underline, but by every word of God. Okay? But by every word of God. Now, I have a list of, watch this, y'all. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17 new modern day versions. And this is what they state. From the NIV, it says, Jesus answered, it is written, man shall not live on bread alone. But what did the KJV say? Let's read the truth again. Read.
It is written that man should not live by bread alone, but by every word of God.
Oh, so the NIV deletes the word of God? But they're going to give this out to you like they give you the word of God? Okay, let's go to the New Living Translation. But Jesus told him, no, the scriptures say people do not live by bread alone. English Standard Version. Jesus answered him, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone. Let me go over here. New Revised Version. Jesus answered, it is written, one does not live by bread alone. Now, this book was copywritten 1989, y'all. Okay, the New Life Version, copywritten in 1969, says, Jesus said unto him, it is written, man is not to live by bread alone. Every word of God is deleted, y'all. Okay, the Message Bible, okay, Luke 4 and 4, listen to this. And Jesus answered by quoting Deuteronomy, it takes more than bread to really live. And every word of God is deleted. Do y'all see the pattern here? They are not giving you the word of God. But these are the new modern day verse. See, brother, see, that's how we talk. See, this is new and better. That's what they're going to say. That's why they're selling it to you. They expect you to put your money on something that does not have the word of God. What's his name? New Century Version. Jesus answered, it is written the scriptures. A person does not live on bread alone. But by every word of God is deleted, y'all. And that book was copywritten in 2005. Okay, oh, they got it in the little footnotes, y'all. See, it's actually not in the manual, you know, wasn't in the original manuscript. They delete the word of God, y'all. So now let's do ourselves a favor. Let's go to, look at the smallest verse in the Bible, y'all. Let's go to St. John 11:35. St. John 11, Make sure I got that up here. St. John 11 and I'm gonna show you. Because what they've done is they take it and they add it to the word and they've taken from the word. So we're gonna go to St. John 11 chapter and verse 35. Make sure I get that. And then we're gonna look at how they mutilated the Lord's Prayer, y'all. They mutilated. So we're gonna look at a little few couple of doctrines right quick. And then we're gonna look at we're gonna go directly into some a few more words here. And make sure I get this right. St. John 11, let me make sure I got, there, I got it right up here. Make sure I got that right. St. John 11 and 35. I think this is the shortest scripture in the Bible. Okay? So now I have here, I'm going to go here to the Message Bible. And St. John 11:35. Yeah. Make sure we got tracking. And we're going to go into the Message and see what they did to the scriptures, okay? To the Message. So let's read St. John 11 and verse 35. Let's read what the truth says.
Jesus what?
That's the simplest, the smallest, the shortest verse in the Bible, y'all, okay? Now listen to what this book called the Message does. Let me make sure I find, because the way they got it, they misconstrued and they actually removed the verse continuity out of this Bible. This Bible is supposed to bring the message of God, but we're going to find out, y'all, who actually is the author of the messages that come out of these new Bibles. So in this book, the Message, it says, let me see, this is so confusing to find. It doesn't even have the verse passage, but that's not here. They deleted it. Wait a minute. And when Jesus saw her sobbing, the Jews with her sobbing, deep anger swelled up with him, and he said, "Where did you put him, Master? Come and see." And they said, "Now Jesus wept." Okay, that's what they said. Now they added, they said, "Now Jesus wept." Why couldn't they just leave that alone? Okay? Why couldn't they just leave plain enough, well, simple, "Now Jesus said"? They added to what wasn't there in the Bible. And now they run wild. We're going to get really, I'm just starting out, y'all. We're just warming this thing up. So now what I'm going to do is go to Acts 8 and 37. Let's go to Acts 8 and 37. Okay, now, Acts 8 and 37, we're going to compare that verse, Acts 8 and 37, let's read the truth, read.
And Philip said, "If thou believest with all thine heart, thou mayest." And he answered and said, "I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God."
Now notice this, y'all. That's what the Word of God says. And Philip said, "If thou believest with all thy heart, thou mayest." And he answered, "I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God." Now isn't this a core principle of being a Christian, y'all? Core principle. Nevertheless, guess what, y'all? Acts 8 and 37 is missing in the New Revised Standard Version. It is missing in the New Standard Version Catholic Edition. It is deleted from the Mons Reverse Interlinear New Testament, and is deleted from the New Living Translation. Now, who would dare delete that? If you believe in Christ, why would you delete, "I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God"? Why would I want to delete that, y'all? Somebody please explain that to me. Nevertheless, we're going to keep it pushing. What I want to do now is go on to doctrine, a little more of doctrine, by going to the Lord's Prayer. Okay? Now, here's the thing. The Lord's Prayer was mutilated by Marcion. And Lord's Prayer, where he mutilated it at, is Luke 11, chapter, verse 2 through 4. Let's go to Luke 11, chapter. And we're going to read it from the truth. And this is one of the Marcion infections that has carried down through the generations. Because Marcion decided to take the Gospel of Luke and remove what he didn't like. And one passage he changed was the Lord's Prayer found in Luke 11's chapter. And he put his own words, he took out the words, and we're going to read what the Lord's Prayer says there in the truth. And then we're going to see what he did to it. And let's read Luke 11 chapter, and we're going to, I'm going to point out what he did delete, okay? So, read Luke 11 chapter and verse 2 through 4.
And he said unto them, "When ye pray, say, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, as in heaven, so in earth. Give us day by day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, for we also forgive everyone that is in debt to us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil."
Now watch this, y'all. I'm finna read from this NIV first, and then I'm gonna read the Message. The NIV states in verse 2, "Father," he said unto them, "when you pray, say, Father." So they deleted "our," underlying the word "our" in your book, if you got the KJV. They deleted "Father." Next thing, "hallowed be your name." So they deleted "which are in heaven." Look how they mutilated the Lord's Prayer. They removed "our Father, which are in heaven." So they replaced it in the NIV, "Father, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come." Watch this. "Give us each day our daily bread." Wait a minute. It said, "thy will be done as in heaven, so in earth." So they deleted that. They took that out. So underline that whole stream right there. They deleted, "thy will be done as in heaven, so in earth." Okay, that's what they deleted. "Forgive us our sins, for we also forgive everyone who sinned against us, and lead us not into temptation." So now, this prayer can be prayed by Satanists or other cultists can use this prayer, y'all, because it leaves our Father, which is in heaven, and people can fill in the blank as they wish, because the term Father is also used by Buddhists, occultists, even Satanists, but there's only one Father, which are in heaven, okay? So this is, they got Marcion's mutilated prayer in the NIV. Let's see what he got in the Message. In the message verse. So he said, "when you pray, Father, reveal who you are, set the world right, keep us alive with 3 square meals, keep us forgiven and you forgiven others, keep us safe from ourselves and the devil." Wait a minute, man. Dude, that sounds the same, y'all. I thought NIV was bad, but wow. I'm like, reveal who you are, set the world right, keep us alive with 3 square meals. And keep us forgiven. Come on, y'all. That's different. Mutilating the Lord's Prayer, y'all. This is what they have done. So let's move on to another doctrine, y'all, that they done did by going to Mark 7th chapter. And this here, I'm going to show you how they collapsed the Bible on itself. We're going to go to Mark 9th chapter. Sorry, 7th chapter. Mark 7. And this is going to get real interesting, y'all. Right now, I'm just hitting on little doctrines, and then we're going to go verse by verse, where they actually deleted Christ, where they changed words that don't make no sense, added words, okay? So, Matthew 7 chapter, and Matthew 7th chapter, and verse, make sure I got this right. Matthew 7, and I want to go verse 15. Let me track it in the NIV in the message. So, Mark. Okay, let me here. Okay. And okay. And it's right at, because the message has a corruption here. I'm trying to line these up so that we see the corruption clearly. So now, we're going to do verse, what we're looking for now is verse 39. Sorry, 19. Mark 7 and 19. This is where they corrupt the Bible. Their Bibles. Now the apostles were right here listening. We got to understand the apostles were here listening to all this stuff. And even Jesus is talking to a crowd. So I'm going to start at 17 and read into this, and you guys see what I mean. Let's start at Mark 17 from the truth, from God's word, and then we're going to see how they corrupted their Bibles. So read Mark 7 and start at verse 17.
And when he was entered into the house from the people, his disciples asked him concerning the parable.
Now look, Peter was here, right? Because that was one of his disciples. John, Mark, all the apostles, his disciples were there. Go ahead.
And he said unto them, are ye so without understanding also? Do ye not perceive that whatsoever thing from without entereth into the man, it cannot defile him? Mm-hmm. Because it entereth not into his heart, but into the belly, and goeth out into the draught, purging all meats.
Now then, total intent and context of this, the Pharisees were trying to say, to eat with unclean hands defileth a man, okay? But we want to see, did God sit here and say that, what we're going to read out of these new books. Now it said purging all meats, okay? Now watch this, let's see what this NIV says, at that very verse 19, okay? Now, hold on. Before we go there, what we're going to do, let's go to Acts 10th chapter and show you exactly what I mean. I want to let the truth define it first. We're going to go to Acts 10th chapter in the book, in the Word of God, and we're going to go to verse, Acts 10, and we're going to go to verse 14. So, right. The Word of God backs up what I said. It didn't mean you can eat everything. It didn't mean all meats is clean. Otherwise, this man we're finna read about that was full of the Holy Ghost when he made this statement. Peter was there, y'all. So let's read what the truth says. So Acts 10th chapter and verse 14. Let's see what Peter said after he had been filled with the Holy Ghost on the day of Pentecost. He is the head of the church. God had given him the Holy Ghost, gave him the keys to the kingdom. He had become the head of the church. and an esteemed among the apostles. He was a leader. This is a man full of the Holy Ghost. And God dealt with Peter, right? Jesus dealt straight up with him. So now watch this. Now watch what Peter said after Jesus' death and resurrection. This is after the cross. This is after the shed blood of Jesus Christ. I want to put it all on the table, y'all. Because you got people saying, oh, brother, we ain't got to worry about what we eat because Jesus shed his blood on Calvary. They get all into that. Well, let's see this man that was actually there. Let's see what he said long after Jesus' death. Actually, about 7 years after Jesus' death, to be exact. Let's see how he felt about eating things. Verse 14, go ahead.
But when Jesus saw it, he was much...
No, Acts 10. Uh-oh. Yeah, Acts 10. We're going to Acts 10. Let's be very clear. We're at Acts 10 chapter, and Peter, this man whom God filled with the Holy Ghost, he received Christ as his personal Savior. All of that. We all know this, y'all. So watch what he said.
10 and 15.
Yeah, 10 and 14. Okay. Let's see what Peter said about eating. Let's see if Mark 7 and verse 19 meant all meats are clean. Let's see what Peter said. Go ahead.
But Peter said, not so, Lord, for I have never eaten anything that is common or unclean.
Oh, wait a minute. The man that actually was standing there when Jesus made this statement, purging all meats, he understood that wasn't talking about you could eat anything. So Peter said, no, not so, Lord, for I have never eaten anything that is common or unclean. Now skip down to verse 28.
And he said unto them, ye know how that is an unlawful thing for a man that is a Jew to keep company or come unto one of another nation. But God has showed me that I should not call any man common or unclean.
So this is what the whole vision was about. To sum it up in a nutshell, Israel engrafting the Gentiles, those that were outside of the commonwealth of Israel, and now they are partakers because what God has cleansed, he said, I should not call any man common or unclean. So that's Mark. Doesn't mean it's all everything you can eat and anything you want to eat and God made every food clean. It don't mean that, right? Now let's go into these new books and we're going to read in what they said right there in Mark 7 and 19. Now this is at the NIV, y'all. Watch what they did. 7 and 19, we'll find it. Okay. For it doesn't go into the heart, but into his stomach, then out of his body. In saying this, Jesus declared all foods clean. That's what they put in the NIV. Okay. In the Message Bible, it states, Jesus said, are you willfully stupid? Don't you see that what you will swallow can't contaminate you? It doesn't enter your heart, but your stomach works its way through the intestines and is finally flushed. That took care of dietary quabblings, Jesus was saying that all foods are fit to eat. That's what they got in these new Bibles. Okay? Now let's go to the very Acts 10th chapter in their Bibles and let's see what Peter says. Okay? Watch this, y'all. Acts 10 and verse 14. You'll find it in the NIV. So here we go. So they're saying, they put it in. They wrote that in parentheses. So Jesus made all foods clean. So now, when we go into Acts 10 chapter in their book that they've copywritten, the same verse, verse 14 in the NIV states, surely, Lord, Peter replied, I have never eaten anything impure or unclean. So in their book, it just disqualified what their book said. In their book. Think about that. Because Peter was there. So the KJV is consistent from before Jesus' death and resurrection to after Jesus' death and resurrection. Peter said, Lord, I have not eaten anything uncommon or unclean. In their book, According to them, Jesus said all foods are clean and you can eat whatever to Peter. But Peter in their book said, Lord, not so. I have never eaten anything impure or unclean. I'm going to skip down to verse 28. See if they kept that the same. And in their book, it says, verse 28, he said unto them, you are aware that it is against our law for a Jew to associate with a Gentile or visit him, but God has shown me that I should not call any man impure or unclean. So their own book collapsed on itself. Because why was Peter keeping a dietary law? If what they book said, that verse means Jesus made all foods clean. It implodes on itself. Does that happen with the Message Bible? Let's go with them going to the Message Bible. And in their Message Bible, Peter said at verse 14, Peter said, oh no, Lord, I've never so much as taste food that was not kosher. So they're putting a Jewish spin on it. Anyway, so now let's get down to verse 28, and let me see. Because the way they, man, they got this all jacked up. They ain't no chart the markers in here. Hold on. Wow. Let me see. Because you have to read every little thing down. Okay, hold on. So let's. Yeah, this Message Bible got the message all misconstrued. You can't even say a verse. So the next morning, Peter goes to the door, Cornelius meets him, pull up, none of that, I am a man, only a man, different talking. Okay, Jews just don't do this, just visit with the people of another race. Here we go. Yeah, you have to find it, and they don't even have verse markers in here. So they got it in like a storybook format. You know how you get a novel, and you just keep reading and reading and reading. They removed all the chapter markers and all the verse markers here. But it says here, in reading this story format, that's another, they changed the format. But God has showed me that no race is better than any other. So the minute I was sent, so that's what they got. That's how they got. Peter addressed, you know, I am sure that this is highly irregular. Jews just don't do this. Visit and relax with people of another race. But God has shown me that no race is better than any other. So this chapter, even in their modern day doctrine, it crushes the fact they go here and say, oh brother, this is talking about food. And it crushes Mark 7 chapter in their corrupt, perverted Bibles. So the doctrine implodes on itself. You got the polluting the Lord's prayer. You got the removing the word of God. You got them added to little baby verses that which is not necessary. Then you got them imploding on themselves, y'all. So now we're going to keep pushing. Now we're going to get to why these Bibles are like this, y'all. And I want to go to Philippians 3 and 20. Show you who the editor of these Bibles really are, y'all. You okay? I'm going to show you who really is the editor of this book. Who's behind these men that created these new books. Now, but we're going to go to Philippians 3 and 20. And then we're going to look at how Satan manipulates and deletes. That's why it's plagues in the land. That's why there's diseases. That's why people are doing exceedingly wicked. That's why they put under possessions of spirits. And we're talking about people sitting up in churches, y'all. The streets gonna do what the streets gonna do, y'all. But right here, Philippians 3 and 20. Philippians 3 and 20. We're gonna hear the truth. And I got a question to ask y'all. You okay? We're gonna hear the truth and then we're gonna look at these other versions. Philippians 3 and 20. Philippians 3 and 20. You get some? Read.
For our conversation is in heaven.
Now hold on. The book said our conversation is in heaven. Can I ask anyone, what is a conversation, y'all? is it a conversation? If we pull up the meaning of a conversation, I want to pull up in a dictionary right quick. Anyway, we all know what a conversation really is, y'all. Conversation is when two people are what? Communicating. We're talking, right? Conversation is about what? Communication. Okay? Conversation. For our conversation is in heaven. In other words, our communication. We're talking about talking, right? Right, y'all? Okay? So, it said, for our conversation is in heaven. Go ahead.
From hence also we look for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ.
Uh-huh. So now the definition of the word conversation is the interchange through speech of information, ideal, or spoken communication. Correct, y'all? You ace the test. If that's the answer, the only answer you need to put down for a conversation, that's what the word conversation means. Now we're going to look at something very, very, very simple, y'all. In Philippians, the third chapter of these corrupt Bibles. And I do mean they are corrupt. I'm trying to find my stream. Because I have a whole list of what they deleted. But I'm gonna go ahead and do these basics right quick. Watch this, y'all. In the New Revised Standard Version, listen to what it says. Now remember, for our conversation is in heaven. But look what they put in the New Bible. But our citizenship is in heaven. Please underline that word, for our conversation. Please underline that in the truth, in the Word of God. What the heck is our conversation got to do with our citizenship? Ain't citizenship something different, y'all? I am a citizen of America. Okay, we are American citizens. Hello? What that got to do with conversation? And this is in the New Revised Standard Version, which is copyrighted in 1989. The Division of Christian Education. I'm like, wow. And they don't know the difference between the conversation and citizenship? Wow. But no, it says our conversation. Now, what I want to do is show you who really is doing this. Hold this spot. And let's go into Luke 18 chapter and Luke 10 chapter, verse 18. Who really come from heaven, y'all? Who really comes from heaven? Luke 10:18. And this is what Jesus said unto his apostles. Read.
And he said unto them, I beheld Satan as lightning fall from heaven.
Because Satan comes from what? Heaven. So when you hear the term, but our citizenship is where? In heaven. Wait a minute. That ain't got nothing to do with your conversation. So whose citizenship are we actually talking about? The fall of Satan. He fell from heaven. Matter of fact, let's go to Revelation 12 chapter and verse 10. And then we're going to get back to this comparison. I just want to point this clearly out. Who's the author of these new, who's behind the men that are putting these new Bibles out, y'all? And we're going to start at Revelation 12 chapter and verse 7. Revelation 12 and verse 7. In the word of God, not the words of men. Okay? Read.
And there was war in heaven.
Uh-huh.
Michael and his angels fought against the dragon.
Uh-huh.
And the dragon fought and his angels.
Uh-huh.
And prevailed not.
Uh-huh.
Neither was there a place found anymore in heaven.
Oh, so their actual citizenship was revoked from heaven. Because that's where they fell from. I find the Lord said, I beheld Satan fall as a bolt of lightning from where? Heaven. So now let's get back to this comparison, y'all. So when it says, but our citizenship is in heaven, and it is there, and from there that we are expecting a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Wait a minute. That ain't got nothing to do with conversation. So Satan is the editor of the New Revised Standard Version Bible, y'all. His fallen angels. Let's see who's the editor of the NIV. Let's see what the NIV says in verse 20. But our citizenship is in heaven. Even the New King James Version got in the mix, y'all. This is the New KJV. Let's see who the author of that really is. For our citizenship is in heaven, from which also we eagerly wait for the Savior, the Lord Jesus. Wait a minute, our citizenship isn't in heaven, y'all. That's Satan's city. He fell from heaven. Because we can read what the Lord told us. Thus we are, and thus we shall what? Return. We are called earthly. We wait to be clothed on with heavenly bodies. We're not heavenly beings. Our citizenship is not in heaven. The Lord created Adam. He said, thus thou art and thus thou shalt return. And when we go and lay down those of us that have passed away, where do we go put them back in, y'all? We put them in the dirt because home is here, not in heaven. Let's see what the New Living Translation says. But we are citizens of heaven, where the Lord Jesus lives. We not. Because when you say the Lord's Prayer, you saying thy kingdom come, thy will be done. Oh, no wonder Marcion deleted that. Because he is of these fallen angels. He was influenced by these fallen angels. So we're going to look at what these fallen angels have influenced in these new translations by going in verse by verse. And we're going to take a look, starting in the book of Matthews. And what we want to do, what I'm going to do is provide a service for you so that you can actually underline the corruptions that they did in every letter of the New Testament. Okay, y'all? So here's what we want to do. We want to go to Matthew 1 and 25. We're just going to read the one verse, and I'm going to tell you what to underline. You okay? I'm looking at my time. We got, I don't know if I'm going to get done with all of this, but I'm going to get as much as possible for you. So when somebody stands up there and come at you with these little funny Bibles, you can answer them and let them show them, look, your Bible removed this, and your Bible added this, or your Bible removed Jesus, or your Bible removed God, and you can prevent to save them from the error of the way and the influence of these evil angels that are proliferated in the houses of these publishers. So right here, Matthew 1 and 25. Now we're going to read the truth, and I want you to, I'll tell you what word to underline. So read Matthew 1 and 25.
And knew her not till she had brought forth her firstborn son. Mm-hmm. And he called his name Jesus.
Now, what they deleted in the NIV, the New American Standard, the Revised Standard, the New Revised Standard, the Living Bible, and the New Christian Bible, they removed the word firstborn, underline firstborn. It is removed. Okay? So put a little highlight that to show that's what they removed. Let's go to Matthew 5 and 22. We're going to hear what the truth said, and then we're going to look at what they deleted. Because the Lord said, you take away from his word, you're going to take away your part out of the book of life. So that's why you need to stay away from these books. You don't want to go into these books, because you're going to end up lost in the sauce. But Matthew 5 and 22, read.
But I send to you that whosoever is angry with his brother without a cause shall be in danger of the judgment.
Guess what they deleted, y'all? They removed the words without a cause out of the NI, the NSI, the RS, and the NRS, and LB, and NC Bible. Let me show you. The New American Standard Bible, the, let me look right here. The New Century Bible, the New Revised Standard Bible, NAS. Let me see who's NAS. NAS. That's New American Standard Bible. Okay, they removed without a cause. Now, Matthew 5 and 44. Let's go skip down to Matthew 5 and 44. and they removed 12 words, y'all. So this is what they did. Read Matthew 5:44.
But I said to you, love your enemies, bless them that curse you, do good to them that hate you, and pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you.
Now what they did, they removed bless them that curse you. They deleted that. Okay? Matthew 6:13.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil, for thine is the kingdom.
So they deleted thine is the kingdom. Underline that. As soon as I get to it, I'll tell you what the underline, so we can keep it going. Go to verse 27. Matthew 6:27.
Which of you, by taking thought, can add one cubit unto his stature? And why take ye thought for remnant? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They toil not, neither do they spin.
Now look, in that 26th verse, Matthew 6:27, you just read that. Now they change cubic to his statue. Okay? Or they changed cubit to his statue, to hour to his life. So they changed the words cubit to his statue. So underline cubit unto his statue, and they changed that to say hour to his life. Okay? Again, they changed the phrase cubit to his statue, underline that, because they changed that to say hour to his life. That's been affected in all these versions. Matthew 6:33. Read.
6:33. Mm-hmm. But seek ye first the kingdom of God.
Guess what? They removed God, y'all. Underline that. Underline the word God. They removed the word God. Who would remove the word God? Think about it. Why would you even bother that? If you were about Christ, if God was in your heart, why remove God? Because they were influenced by these fallen angels. They was kicked out. Remember, they're at war against God. So they had, in the word, in their Bibles, they removed God. They removed the word of God. Go to Matthew 8:29.
And behold, they cried out, saying, what have we to do with thee, Jesus, thou Son of God?
Guess what they did? They removed Jesus. Underline the name of Jesus. They removed Jesus, y'all. Now, who want to remove Jesus? You tell who want to remove Jesus? And they want to put these Bibles in that's coming from God? Really? Okay. Let's go to Matthew 9:13.
But go ye and learn what that meaneth. I will have mercy and not sacrifice, for I am not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance.
Guess what they removed, y'all? To repentance. They deleted that. Underline to repentance. They removed that out of the Bible. Okay? Also, they did that in Mark 2:17. Matthew 11:23. Let's go to Matthew 11:23. And we just found out in the first letter they mutilated, y'all. Mutilated the Gospels. In this, they removed the word hell. So let's see what hell was in Matthew 11:23.
And that Capernaum, which are exalted unto heaven, shall be brought down to hell.
So they removed hell. Wow. The Lord said they're going to be brought down to hell, but they removed that. Okay, let's keep going because I got a lot to get out. So like I said, underline hell. Go to Matthew 12:6. Read.
But I say unto you that in this place is one greater than the temple.
Now look, they changed it from one greater to something greater. So underline one greater They changed that. You okay? Matthew 12 and 35.
A good man out of the good treasure of the heart bringeth forth good things, and an evil man out of the evil treasure bringeth forth evil things.
So they remove the word of the heart. Underline that in your Bibles. In the word of God, they remove of the heart. Let's get down to verse 40. And they changed the word. Go ahead.
For as Jonas was 3 days and three nights in the whale's belly.
Now look, they changed the word whale to fish. Okay? Some even put sea monster. Okay? So they changed whale to fish. And a fish is significantly a what? A whale is a mammal, right? Yes. Last time I checked, whales are pretty doggone big, y'all. Huge. So to sit up there and call a whale a fish, are you serious? Really? You failed the biology class, man. Oceanography class, man. Because fish, you know, they're you know, reasonable size. But a whale? Huge mammals, which gives the Bible. They're trying to take the realism of the book away when they change it to fish. Okay? Some even change it to sea monsters, y'all. Okay? That's the NIV version, the New American Standard. Even the New King James Version corrupts that, y'all. Okay? Every time I come across that, I'm going to point that out. The New Revised Standard and the Living Bible and the New Century Bible. Okay? Now, they removed Matthew 12 and 47 all together. Let's see what Matthew 12 and 47 said, y'all. Read.
Then one said to him, behold, thy mother and thy brethren stand without, desiring to speak with thee.
It's gone. That is not in the Bible. In there, the New International Version removes it. The Revised Standard Bible removes it. And the New Revised Standard Bible removes that. So let's go to Matthew 13 and 51. And they remove the word Lord. Let's see what it says.
Jesus said unto them, have ye understood all these things? They said unto him, yeah, Lord.
So they removed the word Lord. Okay? Matthew 15 and verse 8. They removed draw a knife unto me with their mouth. Let's go to Matthew 15 chapter and verse 8.
This people draw a knife unto me with their mouth.
They deleted that, y'all. Removed it. In a New International Version, the New American Standard, the Revised Standard, New Revised Standard, the Living Bible, and the New Century Bible, they removed. So underline, this people draw the knife to me with their mouth. Did y'all see what's going on? And this stuff is filling up the churches, y'all. You go to a Bible study on a Tuesday night, Wednesday night, Thursday, and pick one of these churches. You be, your Bible don't say what my Bible say. What your Bible say? Your Bible don't say what? The verse is missing? Really? Dude, how come your Bible don't have this people draw the knife to me with their mouth, but mine's do? They removed that, y'all. Think about it. So let's go to Matthew 16 and 3. And let's see, they removed the word hypocrites. Oh boy, no wonder they want to remove the word hypocrites, huh? Think about it. Matthew 16 and verse 3, read.
And in the morning it will be foul weather today, for the sky is red and lowering, O ye hypocrites.
So they removed that. Wonder why they didn't want nobody to see that. And why they wanted to take that out. Put the finger on them and put, look, it says they remove ye to you. It said, oh, ye hypocrites. Go to verse 18 in the same chapter. I'm trying to move at a rapid pace so we can at least get through the Gospels. Because I'm looking at the time peradventure. We get into some of Paul's letters where they really jack stuff up, y'all. Woo! Skip down to verse, go all the way down to, underline verse, hell in Matthew 16 and 18, underline that.
And I said also unto thee that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail.
So they removed hell from there. Underline the word hell. Go to verse 20. And they removed Jesus again. Go ahead. Come on, y'all. Who gonna remove Jesus? bullet.
Then charged he his disciples that they should tell no man that he was Jesus the Christ.
Wow, so they just straight removed Jesus. So that's probably what they got in their book is the Christ, okay? Matthew 17:21.
Howbeit, this kind goeth not out by prayer and fasting.
Guess what, y'all? I'm going to kind of simulate the Bible study a little bit. And let's read from the NIV, see if it's in there. Matthew, you had a Bible study. Everybody's at the Bible study. And we're here with our KJV Bible. And we're here with our Jehovah's Witness Bible. Okay? And we are sitting down at a Bible study. We come to worship God. We come to get some understanding. And we're going to all meditate. So now, I read out of the King James Version in Matthew 17, chapter verse 21. Yeah, Matthew 17, chapter and verse 21. And let's see what I get. I get the KJV. So I got the KJV. Then we have somebody with the NIV. And somebody with the Message Bible. And somebody with the New World Translation Scriptures. Because, you know, it's a better version. This is how we talk, y'all. We like these Bibles, y'all. Let's see what it says in verse 21 out of the KJV. Read that. Again. Read that. Matthew 17 and 21. Read it again, son. Read it again.
How be it this kind goeth not out but by prayer and okay. fasting?
So now I got my guy, my sister with the NIV Bible, and I said, hey, sister, what do Matthew 17 and 21 say in your Bible?
It's not there.
No, wait a minute. Hold up. Who will remove, howbeit this kind goeth not out but by prayer and fasting? It's not in the NIV? Now, wait a minute. I just read this out of the Word of God, but then somebody that prefers, you know, this new NIV, then you ain't got it. Now, let's see what the Jehovah's Witness Bible does. Let's see what the Jehovah's Witness Bible says.
The Jehovah's Witness Bible does not have it.
No! So the Jehovah's Witness Bible ain't got it. And they'll tell you, see, you removed the word Jehovah, they ain't got it removed out of the Bible some 7,700 times. But their Bible is missing. Howbeit this kind goeth not out but by prayer and fasting? Amazing. Very, very, very vividly amazing. So now let's go to Matthew's 18th chapter and verse 11. Matthew's 18th chapter and verse 11. Let's read what the KJV says, and we're at the Bible study. And you know, we're all there, and we're there to study God's Word, and, you know, we have our various translations in the midst of us, and I have my KJV, and I read, what is this, son?
For the Son of Man has come to save that which was lost.
So the Son of Man has come to save that which is lost. Let's see what the NIV says there.
It's not there.
It's not there.
They have a manuscript. It's a little letter that you gotta go at the bottom of the page.
Oh, whoa, whoa, whoa. So, why would you even tell? Look, I am a Christian, and I believe Jesus has come to save that which is lost. Why would I remove that unless it's those angels that fed this book? Those books come from the fallen angels, and they don't want you to be saved. Because they said he come to save that which is lost, and they remove that. And that, let's see if the Jehovah's Witness Bible get there. Let's see what it says there, y'all. Let's see what it says there. Read.
The Jehovah's Witness Bible does not have it.
So the Jehovah's Witness Bible does not have that verse. Very, very, very interesting. And you probably got a Jehovah's Witness getting ready to knock at your door right about now. And you need to ask him, why does your Bible remove the Son of Man to come save that which is lost? Who is the editor of your Bible?
But
Hmm. But it has a little footnote thingy, right? You know, they don't want.
It's a sea glossary.
Yeah, a sea glossary. So you got to look somewhere other than the Word of God. Very, very interesting who edited these passages, y'all. Very, very interesting verses that we should see that are deleted. Now let's go to Matthew, 18 and 26. Read Matthew's 18 chapter and verse 26. Now we all at this Bible study, y'all. And got Sister So-and-so, she's sitting there with her book, and you sitting there with your book, the KJV. And they're sitting there with one of these NIVs, NASs, RSs, NRS, one of the NC Bibles. And let's read what Matthew's 18 chapter and verse 26 says. Read.
The servant therefore fell down and worshiped him, saying, Lord, have patience with me, and I will pay thee all.
And let's see what the NIV says, y'all, in Matthew's 18, 26.
NIV, Matthew's 18:26. The servant fell on his knees before him. Be patient with me, he begged.
Whoa. So they remove worship and worship him. They remove that for Jesus. Why would you want to remove worship for Jesus? And it's written plain, and worship him. They remove it. This is how we know that these Bibles are influenced by these fallen angels. Let's see if the Jehovah's Witness Bible got it in there. And Matthew 18 and 26.
So the slave fell down and he did obedience to him, saying, be patient with me, but I will pay you back everything to you.
So now they changed the word, it said obedience.
To him saying, be patient.
So now they took a simple word that don't need no, everybody know what worship means. Anybody need to elaborate on that? It's very simple, because you got people going, see, that KJV is hard to understand. Nobody talks like that. But then they go get these new Bibles and make it more complicated. Right. They twist worship to obedience? That's, I can't even spell it. I mean, I had to think about how to spell O-B-E-S-I-N-C-E. That's sure not spell worship. I got an 8th grader that 8-year-old can spell it too, y'all. Worship. You can spell it, but I ain't gonna put it on the line like that. Nevertheless, we keep pushing, y'all. Let's go to Matthew 19 and 9. Matthew's 19 chapter and verse 9. Read.
And I say unto you, whosoever shall put away his wife, except it be for fornication, and shall marry another committed adultery. And whosoever marrieth her which is put away doeth commit adultery.
Now let's go into this NIV, y'all, and see what we got going, y'all. Let's see what if we get the same thing, y'all. Let's see if we get the same thing. Matthew's 18 and 11. Matthew's 18 and 11. Now picture we at this Bible study, y'all. I'm trying to get is simulating the situation that if you got the KJV and you walk into somebody's Bible study on a Tuesday or Wednesday or Thursday, you're most likely going to encounter the very thing we're simulating here and now. So let's read that. What did it say? Matthew's. Matthew's 18. I think it's Matthew 18 and, 19 and 9. Yeah, Matthew's 19 and 9. That's what we read.
Matthew's 19 and 9 from the NIV International Version.
Okay.
I tell you that anyone who divorces his wife except for marital unfaithfulness and marries another woman commits adultery.
Okay. Wow. So it deleted, and whosoever marries her which is put away doth commit adultery. So they deleted that part. Let's see what they did for the Jehovah's Witness Bible.
I say to you that whoever discovers his wife except on the grounds of sexual immorality and marries another commits adultery for her.
And that's it. You're done. So they too eliminate. And whoso marries her, which is put, so underline that last part, whoso marries her, which is put away, doth commit adultery. They delete that part. Let's keep it on moving. Let's go to, skip down to verse 17 in the same chapter, because they change it, the word. And it changed, why callest thou me good? Underline that. Underline, why callest thou me good? Okay? And we're going to see what they changed it to, y'all.
And he said unto him, why callest thou me good? Mm-hmm. There is none good but one, that is God. But if thou wilt enter into life, keep the commandments.
A very, very good scripture. Anyway, but we're not here for that part, y'all. That's somebody need to hear that. But anyway, we're here because they changing the words. So let's see what the NIV says.
NIV, Matthew 19:17. Why do you ask me about what is good?
Whoa, wait a minute. That is different, y'all. That is very different. So they changed, why callest thou me good, to why do you ask me about what is good? That's different. These Bibles are not saying the same thing, y'all. Why? But they are influenced by these fallen angels down in this war zone, and they are here to take away the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God, so that you are a casualty in the fight. That's why we have on our website the war zone. So you can go in there and armor up, gird yourself for it, sword up, righteousness up, everything stand up. Don't fall for this foolishness. Because these scriptures that they're calling from God are not. They remove the word of God, y'all. And this clearly is a clear example of changing. Why callest thou me good to? Why do you ask me about what is good? Come on, y'all. Everybody know that's different. Let's keep it pushing. Let's go. Oh, sorry. Let's see the Jehovah's Witness Bible. Let's see how.
I'm going to finish the rest of that.
You do? Okay.
Why do you ask me about what is good?
Uh-huh.
Jesus replied, there is only one who is good. If you want to enter into life, obey the commandments.
Okay.
So he didn't say who was good.
Right. Let's see what the Jehovah's Witness Bible says. So we're not going to read everything because I'm trying to get, I'm looking at the time. So we're going to keep a pace. That's, so. Read, go ahead.
He said to him, why do you ask me about what is good? One, there is who is good. If though you want to enter into life, observe the commandments continually.
Observe the commandments continually. The Jehovah's Witness said the commandments done away with. Wow. They don't book kill him. That's another lesson though. Anyway. So we see, why callest thou me good? They change these words to why do you ask me about what is good? Let's skip down in the same chapter. Actually, they removed the word God too. So two things happened in there. Let me note that. Two things. They removed the word God and they made changes in it. Two things in one verse, y'all. So let's go to Matthew 20:7. Yeah, I think I'm going to walk this until part three, y'all. Because we just going to do the Gospels. We're going to break this piece down. And we're going to walk it next week. We're going to go into, hopefully get done with the Gospels today. We're going to get into this in closing next week. We might go past that because this is very, very essential for our salvation, y'all. Very. You can help save some people by showing them, look, your Bible did this. Or your Bible did that. And they may not even be aware, you know, because of the deception and how deceiving and how seducing spirits out here got people so enthralled in these books. They're not aware of the good common sense that's been taken away from them. The Lord is merciful, y'all. So we can be merciful to those who do have these corrupt Bibles. And prevention, when you show them what's wrong with their book, they might be like, hey, I didn't know that's ridiculous. When you hear what the truth is, okay? So we're going to Matthew's 20th chapter and verse 7. And what we're going to do is, go ahead, read verse 7.
They say unto him, because no man hath hired us, He said unto them, go ye also into the vineyard.
Oh, you in Matthew 27? 20th chapter?
Yeah, 27.
And verse 7? Let me show them there. I'm in Matthew 20 and verse 7. They said unto him, because no man had hired us. Okay, go ahead.
He said unto them, go ye also into the vineyard, and whatsoever is right, that shall ye receive.
So now what they did, underline, and whatsoever is right, that shall you receive. They removed that. They deleted that. So let's see what the NIV says.
Matthew 27, NIV. Because no one has hired us, they answered. He said to them, you also go and work in my vineyard.
Wow. Let's see what the Jehovah's Witness Bible does.
They replied, because nobody has hired us. He said unto them, you can go into the vineyard and feed on what is yours.
Okay, they deleted and took away. Okay, interesting. What the message book say? I want to see what the message says. Because the message reads like a storybook. They don't, I know that's it's, you can get a fix on that. Yeah, it's real. Mm-hmm.
Right, because they don't have no verses.
Yeah, they don't have no verses. It's like they think the book, the Bible is another novel. You know, just make
it. Say the story about workers. Okay, I think
the story about workers. Okay.
They said, because no one hired us, he told them to go to work in his vineyard.
Wow. And whatsoever is right, that shall you receive. They underlined that. They deleted that. So let's keep going on to, skip down to verse 16. Verse 16. So read what it says in the truth.
So the last shall be first, and the first shall, and the first last.
Uh-huh.
For many be called, but few chosen.
So the word of God says the last shall be first, and the first shall be last. That's why we on the last day of this week for worship, that we may come up in the first resurrection. The ones that's in the first day of the week, they coming up in that last resurrection for this stuff. And I hope they hope that God, you know, that's why the Lord's merciful, peradventure, they can repent, turn from their wicked ways, turn from this influence of these evil angels in these new Bibles, and hey, turn to the last day so that they may be in the first resurrection. Anyway, well, let's see what they changed and what they took away in the NIV.
Matthew 20 and 16.
Uh-huh.
So the last will be first, and the first will be last.
Mm-hmm. Uh-oh. Is that all? Roger that. Just picture you at a Bible study, and you hear that, you be like, where the rest of that at? Are you serious? Dude, what book you got? What's that? So that's out of the NIV. Let's see what the Jehovah's Witness Bible say, y'all. Go ahead. Go ahead. Let me get some volume. Let me get some volume. Speak up.
In this way, the last one will be first, and the first one will be last.
Uh-huh.
Therefore, that is.
No. That's it? That's how she wrote? And I thought that book's gonna be better. Look at King James whipping the, you know what, out of these new translated Bibles. Because they deleted underline, for many be called, but what? Few chosen. Many be called, but few chosen. Let's keep it going, y'all. We left off from Matthew 16 chapter and verse 16. Let's go to Matthew 20:20. All right, we already dealt with that. We're underlining Matthew 20:20. Underline worship him. Because they changed that to kneeling down. They changed that. So let's go to, in the same chapter, we'll skip down to verse 22. I'm going to kind of outline some things. Matthew 20th chapter and verse 22. Yeah, we're going to read Matthew's 20th chapter, verse 22, out the word of God, uncopywritten. Read.
But Jesus answered and said, ye know not what ye ask. Are ye able to drink of the cup that I shall drink? And to be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with? They said unto him, we are able.
Yes, sir. Now let's see what the NIV says.
Matthew 20:22.
Mm-hmm.
You don't know what you are asking, Jesus said to them. Can you drink the cup I am going to drink? We can, they answered.
Whoa! So they underlined, and to be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized. They deleted that. They removed that, y'all. Let's see what the new, the Joel Williams Bible says, y'all. Underline that. They deleted that. And to be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with.
Jesus answered, that is, you do not know what you are asking for. For I am. Can you drink of the cup I am about to drink?
Wow, they mutilated that. Okay. So you can project. So now let's go to Matthew 21:44. Let's read out of the uncopyrighted Bible. In this ring, we got the KJV. Let's read, y'all. Matthew 21:44.
And whosoever shall fall on this stone shall be broken, but on whomsoever it shall fall, it will grind him to powder.
Uh-huh. So now let's go to the NIV in this corner.
Matthew 21:44. He who falls on this stone will be broken to pieces, but he on whom it falls will be crushed.
Okay, so they say crushed. Okay, let's see what the Jehovah's Witness Bible says.
Also, the person falling on the stone will be shattered, as for anyone whom it falls will be crushed him.
Interesting. So they got that in there, but it's got it worded a different way, don't they? Okay? Let's go to 23:14. KJV, much clearer right there. Ground it to powder. 23:14.
Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for ye devour widows' houses, and for a pretense make long prayer, therefore ye shall receive the greater damnation.
Okay, let's see what's in the NIV.
Well, that's a small b.
No, oh, wait a minute, so.
In the main, so you gotta look at the
So Bible. They deleted it, huh? It
says, some manuscripts to you teachers of the law and Pharisees, you hypocrites. Widow
house. Oh, so that's not in the passage. So they actually remove that from the passage.
You gotta read it at the bottom.
You gotta read it at the bottom. Okay, so they adjusted their Bible.
More severely.
Wow. Let's see what the whole Witness Bible does.
It's not there.
It's not there. Wow. Got a minus sign, huh?
No. Yeah. Well, yeah.
They got a minus. Oh, so they subtract. They take away from the Word of God. We read last week. You take away from this book.
Well, you have to read at the bottom of the
page. Oh, you have to go outside of the passage. You got to go
see the glossary.
See the glossary, really? Wow. See how simple the KJV is? Everything's laid out. God's word is laid right there in front of you. Simple, easy. You ain't got to worry about seeing no glossaries and all this external stuff. It's there. But these new Bibles, wow. Wow.
And look at the
comfort. Wow. So now let's go to 23:33. Now they made a change here of damnation to condemn. Underline the word damnation. 23:33.
Ye serpents, ye generation of vipers, how can ye escape the damnation of hell?
Now they changed that word damnation. Let's see how they changed it in NIV.
Matthew 23:33.
Mm-hmm.
You snakes, you brood of vipers, how will you escape being condemned to hell?
Oh, so now they changed damnation to condemned. Is that the same thing they did to Jehovah's Witness Bible?
Serpents, offspring of vipers, how will you flee from the judgment of God? Gehenna.
Gehenna. So they took away damnation and they changed hell to Gehenna. Wow. Wow. Ain't that, now which is simpler to understand, hell, y'all, or Gehenna? Like, Gehenna? What's that? That's a little small town out in France somewhere? Anyway.
Vienna.
Huh?
No, that's Vienna.
Oh, that's Vienna. All right, yeah. Dang. Anyway. Oh, yeah, this gets funny, y'all. So let's go to 24 and 36. Yeah, we're going to be a minute on this one, y'all. Matthew 24 and 36.
But of that day and hour knoweth no man, no, not the angels of heaven, but my Father only.
Hmm. Go ahead, read that out the NIV.
Matthew 24 and 36. Did you read?
Yeah.
No one knows about that day or hour, not even the angels in heaven, nor the Son, but only the Father.
Wow, so they added nor the Son to that verse. So one passage you got, they adding, so they add to nor the Son. They added that in there. Mm-hmm. Let's see what the Jehovah's Witness write.
Concerning that day and hour, nobody knows, neither the angel of heaven nor the Father, nor the Son.
And they added nor the Son. Wow. So they added Jesus in there, huh? Wow. Let's keep it going, y'all. By going to the book of, let's move right along. We're going to go to Mark. Again, we're going down piece by piece, y'all. We're looking at how they done mutilated the New Testament to the extent where you ain't got the Word of God. We got more in Matthew's. Matthew 25 and 13. Now we're going to read in this corner, the KJV, uncopyrighted. And Matthew 25 and verse 13.
Watch therefore, for ye know neither the day nor the hour wherein the Son of Man cometh.
So let's read what this these copyrighted Bibles say. Same 25 and 13. Now the Revised Standard Version said it do the same thing. The New Revised Standard Version do the same thing. And the Living Bible do the same thing. I'm going to start stating that in this. And I'm thinking about having this on a website, putting this on our website as a handout so that you can have this as a little handy dandy printout in your own, the privacy of your own home. And then you can start comparing against when somebody come to your house with a Jehovah's Witness Bible. Then you can sit to that. Did you know your Bible missing this? Let me help you out. Anyway, so let's read again Matthew 13 in the NIV. Mm-hmm. Read.
Therefore keep watch, because you do not know the day or the hour.
Wow. So they deleted wherein the Son of Man cometh.
Wow.
Keep going. Let's read what the Jehovah's Witness Bible say.
Keep watch, therefore, because you know neither the hour nor the day of his time.
Of whose time?
Yeah, or the time. Yeah, whose time? Wow. That's what that book said? Talk about evil angel influence, huh? Anyway, they don't want you to know where the Son of Man coming. There you go. So let's keep going, 25. Now we're going to go to Matthew 27 and 35. 27 and 35. Again, we're going piece by piece, y'all. We're going to walk this till we get done. Matthew 27 and 35. Matthew 27, chapter, verse 35. In this corner, look like it's a knockout to me, y'all. We just in the first book of the New Testament. Okay. Wow. So the same thing that we're going to see is also in NIV, New American Standard, Revised Standard, the New Revised Standard, and the Living Bible, and the New Century Bible. So Matthew 27 and 35, read.
And they crucified him and parted his garments, casting lots, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the prophet. They parted my garments among them, and upon my vesture did they cast lots.
Now this is about Jesus showing you how that which is spoken of by the prophets was being fulfilled. So now let's look at the NIV, verse 35.
Matthew 27 and 35. When they had crucified him, they divided up his clothes by casting lots.
And that's it. They removed the last, 25 words, that it might be fulfilled which is spoken of by the prophet, that they parted my garments among them, and upon my vesture did they cast lots. Let's see what the Jehovah's Witness Bible does. Go ahead.
When they had nailed him to the stake, mm-hmm. he distributed the outer garments by casting lots to which it was.
Uh-huh. Wow, talk about a mutilation. It don't even mention nothing about the prophets, huh? Read that one more time.
They had nailed him to the stake and distributed his outer garments by casting lots.
Wow, so they flat out removed that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the prophets. They parted my garments among them and upon my vesture. And then they put, now they put in, they cast lots. Mm-mm. So underline that. Yeah, we're going to finish the book of Matthew, y'all. We're going to keep this thing going. So Matthew 27 and 54. Skip all the way down to verse 54. Now, here's what they did. In this particular, I got to notice, I want you to underline the word, the Son. Now, Son is capitalized. Okay, and it makes a difference between the capitalized S and a small S. Like, we're sons of God, small S. Okay? We're not the Son of God, we're sons of God. There's a big difference between the Son and being the Son of God. Because Jesus is fully God, the Son. Okay? We're sons of God by virtue of bearing the words of God. Big difference, y'all. We can die. We're still flesh and blood. We still have to endure to the end. Jesus has overcome to be the Son of God. So they changed the word capital S to a small s. So to diminish the deity of Christ. So read verse 27, verse 54.
Now when the centurion and they that were with him watching Jesus saw the earthquake and mm-hmm. those things that were done, mm-hmm. they feared greatly, saying, truly, this was the Son of God.
So now underline the word Son. Make sure you underline that, because in the NIV and New, I know in the Jehovah's Witness Bible, they don't want you to think Jesus is God at all. I mean, that's just a whole nother lesson. Nevertheless, well, you do have some Christians that believe that too. So truly, this was the Son, capital S-O-N. Underline that word, Son. Now let's read what the NIV says.
When the centurion and those with him who were guarding Jesus saw the earthquake and all that had happened, they were terrified and exclaimed, surely he was the Son of God.
So that Son is a what? Small s, huh?
There's a B. So you got to look at the bottom. It says, or a son, small
s. Or a small s. Wow. So the question whether he's the Son of God or whether he's been begotten, because Jesus is the only begotten. He is the Son of God. You have the Father and the Son. Mm-hmm. Okay? Both of them caps. Let's read what the Jehovah's Witness Bible says.
But when the army officer and those with him keeping watch over Jesus saw the earthquake and the things happening, he grew very much afraid and said, certainly his God was son.
Huh? This God was son? That's how they say that?
Yeah.
This God was son, and that son is a capital S or small s?
It's capital.
Oh, so this God was son, so they reversed it. This God was son. Wow, so we're talking about a bad grammar. Okay.
Do the thing that says small s at the bottom?
Small s. It says, or memorial tomb, or memorial tomb.
Wow. What's it say in the little small print?
Or memorial tombs.
Or memorial
tomb.
From
verse 52.
That was, we were on 54. Yeah, we were on 54, right. So they said, truly this was, they said, God's son?
25.
Yeah, 27 verse 54.
Certainly this was God's son. Has a capital S.
So, oh, they do have a capital S on that. So, oh, so, okay, they got capital S on that. So they're admitting that Jesus is God in that book. Yes. But the NIV don't want you to know that he's God. Interesting. Mm-hmm. But the Jehovah's Witness doctrine is that Jesus is not God, but he's the son of God. So, wow. That's another bag of cats. So let's keep pushing. We almost done with this, and we almost going to close this out. Let's go 28 in verse 2. In this corner, we got the KJV. What number round is this? Anyway.
And behold, there was a great earthquake, for the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat upon it.
Okay, that's what the truth said. That's what God's uncopyrighted word says, unbound. Let's see what the copywriters say in the NIV.
Matthew 28:2. There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven and, going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it.
It came to the tomb and sat on it. So underline what they deleted there. They deleted, what was that? They deleted from the door. And it changed something there, because it came and rolled, they removed the word, and rolled back the stone. They removed and rolled back the stone from the door and sat upon it. What do the Jehovah's Witness Bible say?
And look, a great earthquake had taken place, for Jehovah's angel had descended from heaven and had come to roll away the stone, and he was sitting on it.
As he was sitting upon it. So they removed from the door in that book. Okay? And the last one we want to go is 28 in verse 9. Read. And after as, truth, yes.
And as they went to as they went to tell his disciples, behold, Jesus met them, saying, all hail.
Uh-huh.
And they came and held him by the feet and worshiped him.
Now let's see what they deleted here. They took from here, and as they went to tell his disciples, underline that. And as they went to tell his disciples. So we're going to read from the NIV, Matthew 28:9.
Suddenly Jesus met them.
Whoa. So they deleted that. As they went to tell his disciples, it says, suddenly Jesus met them. So they deleted that. That's why I said, underlined in the truth, that they removed as they went to tell his disciples. So let's read the Jehovah's Witness Bible. See, did they do the same thing?
And look, Jesus met them and said, good day.
Wow.
They approached and took hold of his feet and did
Okay, so they did the same thing. They removed, and as they went to tell his disciples, behold, Jesus met them saying, all hell. So they deleted it too. Okay? So we just went through the book of Matthews, and they just brutalized it, mutilated it, changed words, deleted Christ, removed entire verses. And then we was at the Bible study, and we all was trying to read this thing together. We'd be sitting out there talking about, what your book say? And that's just in the book of Matthew, y'all. So hope you can join us next week. We're going to go into part three of this, y'all, because there's a lot here. I'm, like I said, I might end it on part three, but I'm going to get, that's just for the Gospels. I might take it to Paul's letters and go into some deletions there. And if they did that much to Matthews, trust me, I got plenty on Luke. Mark. Because they got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25 places where they mutilated the book of Mark. Okay? So, well, we got a little way to go with this one, y'all. So I hope you guys are understanding this day of the copyrighted Bible versus the KJV. It is no contest, y'all. Okay? So far, in this corner, the KJV is standing tall. And in the copyrighted Bible corner, I hope you stay tuned for next week, part three.